Good evening. Welcome to the Portsmouth Board of Adjustment meeting for March 18, 2014. As you can see, this evening we have six sit-in board members, and on a few petitions, we have some board members who need to recuse themselves, which will bring us down to five voting members. Whenever a petition does get to five voting members, the applicant has the option of requesting a postponement. And we do have two such requests for this evening, so I am going to go out of order just to note to the public who may be here waiting for a certain petition. But the petition for 303 Islington Street has requested to be postponed till the April meeting, and also the petition for 159 Middle Street has requested postponement till the April meeting. So just if you're here for either of those petitions, those won't be heard this evening. And I'll just give a heads up. We have just become aware that on the 75 Albany Street petition, we will have five voting members, but we have not heard from the applicant whether they want to so move forward or not. So as it stands now, we do plan on hearing 75 Albany Street, although that too may be requested to be postponed. That said, the first order of business this evening will be the approval of minutes for April 16, 2013. Are there any corrections or comments for those minutes? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to accept those minutes.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
The minutes have been approved. First item under old business is the motion for rehearing for 111 Maple Avenue. This was case 1-7. The petition of Robin Bellantone, Karen Buffard, George Dodge, Erica Dodge, Martha Fuller Clark, Claire Kittredge, Susan Lager, Paul Manley, Dr. Barry McArdle, Natalie Roman Nelson, Neil DiPoli, Doug Roberts, Jerry Hadjimark, Deborah DeMont, and Slattery and DeMont LLC. Property located 111 Maple Avenue. Assessor plan map 124, lot 8, zoning district central business A, historic and downtown overlay. And they're requesting a rehearing for the granting of a certificate of approval for this property. As the board knows, there's two criteria in granting a rehearing. One is new information that was not available to the applicant prior, and also if they felt there was an error, procedural error by the board. Open it up for discussion or entertain a motion. This one item was a 4-hour meeting, so it wasn't for lack of effort, I don't think.
Take a stab at it.
Okay.
Make a motion to deny the application.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Your motion, please.
I've taken a look at the both the application and the response here. And when I first saw it and, you know, see that we misunderstood, we misjudged and so forth, and we didn't give everything a complete airing. I just think that's incorrect. I think we heard everything. We heard from everybody. We were here for hours listening. Everybody had a chance to say what they had to say. And I don't feel for a minute that we were confused or duped or whatever else. I think we were clear. And so based on that and then the fact that I see no new evidence and no procedural error, I would motion that we deny this.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with what Mr. LeMay just said. I would simply add that it was anyone who was here is aware that it was a long hearing. It was thorough. There was keen attention to all the speakers. The board, I think, understood clearly that we were dealing with an overlay a district as well as the underlying zoning requirements. So we have two sets of requirements. Excuse me. I think various aspects of the HDC criteria, objectives and so forth were all considered, and there was comment on relevant parts of it. The both sides had speakers who addressed the issues in a cogent and thorough fashion, so I think there can't be any concern that the issue didn't get a thorough hearing, at least as much we can do in 4 hours. So I support the motion.
Any further comment from the board? I'll just comment, you know, the submittal for the request to hearing had stated several points why we should rehear it, but they were very much the same points that were stated at the original presentation, so for me there's no new material or that's been presented to the board. I think everything presented we had heard before. With that said, I will call for a vote. The motion is to deny the request for rehearing. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Ayoun?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
And chair votes yes. Petition has been denied. Moving on to case 2-4. This petition was previously postponed at the February meeting. This is the petition of Carolyn Cole and Alistair James Ferguson Cole, a property located at 40 Mill Pond Way, Assessor Plan Map 143, Lot 6, in the Zoning District General Residence A. They're looking to remove an existing two-story detached non-conforming structure and build an attached 20-foot by 36-foot two-story garage, an 11-foot by 24-foot connector, and a 3-foot by 9-foot one-story balcony. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 to allow a lawful non-conforming building or structure to be extended or reconstructed without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. A variance from Section 10.521 to allow a building coverage of 30.9%, where 25% is allowed, a left side yard setback of 6.5 feet, where 10 feet is required, a rear yard setback of 18 feet, where 20 feet is required. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Yes. This is Kara Cole. I thought maybe I could just do a quick summary of where we were before and what's kind of progressed since the last meeting. So at the last meeting I proposed a design that brought the building back into code on two setbacks. It was the rear and the side. And I needed a variance for a percentage of lot size. I did want to actually make a point too that my lot is irregular in shape, but it's actually also under the minimum, which is the residential A, should be 7,500 square feet. It's 6,099 square feet. So if it was the minimum, I probably wouldn't have had to come for a variance to begin with, but it is. And so it's under that size. It's just irregular, and I'd probably have to get a variance for anything I'd want to do. Some concerns were raised at the last meeting by two of my neighbors on Dennett Street. It was Petra Hula, who's at 208 Dennett, and Grace Duke at 206 Dennett, about our proposed design and the possible impact of their water view, thereby potentially impacting their property value. They also mentioned the fact that there were some concerns about the height of the new garage may cast a larger shadow across their yard. So I spoke with both the neighbors, and my husband and I went and redesigned our addition to make it more sympathetic to their cause. So we pushed it back closer to where the garage currently sits, but it did make it wider. So we talked to both of them about that. The one thing that it does is it, however, makes it a greater, provides some greater leniency on your part, because now I'm asking for more variances than what I was originally proposing. I've prepared some slides that will address those concerns that were raised around the view, the shade, and by proxy, the property value. And one additional point I wanted to mention about property value that I didn't mention before was that when we started this whole process, my husband and I actually sat and had to decide whether or not building and extending the house was a viable option versus just, you know, selling it and buying something that was bigger, that was more suited to our family. And we did meet with some realtors about what the current property value is and what the proposed property value would be if we went through with the addition. And they validated that if we went down this doing the addition, that the value of the property would increase by $100,000 to $125,000. So I see that as a positive impact on my neighborhood by having my value of my property be increased by so much. So for the slide, so I just want to show some things. One of the things I noticed when working with the site plans that are provided by the town, I know that's the tax maps, but I do want to acknowledge that the scale of those tax maps is not accurate. And I did reach out to a surveyor to see if they could come and survey my land. Unfortunately, they have such a backlog due to the snow that it wasn't a timely thing that they could do. Also, it was quite costly. It was $1,400 for me to actually do the survey. So I'm going based off of the lot size that as it's measured and as I know it, because there were some markers in the front left and there's a marker in the rear, so I can at least use those that were there from when I bought the house. So the points that I wanted to make here is that with the new proposal, we would be actually abiding by the current left side setback, and we did talk to the neighbors about that, about keeping it at the same distance that it is today with the current garage, and they were okay with that. But of course, it's up to you, it's not really up to them, but they said that was okay. And we are pushing it back further so it's in line with the porch. I know some the neighbors at 208 Dennett were would prefer it to go back even further, back to the house. But if we were to do that, then we would actually lose valuable yard space, and we're trying to keep as much green space as possible. And frankly, we don't really need six parking spaces. I'd rather have more yard than parking spaces. So if we could keep it to where the porch aligns, it looks symmetrical, and it does give us more valuable yard space in the back. So pulling it up to the in line in the rear actually gives us an 18-foot setback. The reason why it's not exactly 20 is because that Mason Lane actually is a slight gradual angle. So it's not exactly parallel to the current house. And so that's why we asked for that 18-foot setback. But it does give me an extra 231 square feet of usable green space in our back garden, and actually does improve the view for Grace, who's at 206 Dennett Street, because she looks down that alley, that path. Is there questions about the site map?
Any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
So in your previous application, you had indicated that the garage was 6 feet from the side property line that was adjacent to the, the next property over. In your most recent application, you're showing 6.5 feet to your new proposed garage, which on your illustration that you provided us seems to be closer to the property line than the existing garage.
I can explain that. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to clarify those dimensions.
It was because I actually used the scale to draw the house, and because the scale doesn't match the current lines, it made it look bigger than what it is, because the actual lines that if you use the scale on your map, the 111 actually measures to 108, and that 85 only measures to 80. Mm-hmm. And so it's actually bigger than what it proposed. And so when I drew the garage, it sat outside the lines of the current garage structure, and I just didn't know if I should go use the lines that were in there or do it the way it was actually scaled using your scale. But it would, I can assure you, we won't exceed where the current garage sits.
Okay, and that's mostly what I wanted to validate is you're convinced that your garage is currently about 6.5 feet from the property line, and that your new structure will be at the exact same location.
Okay, yep. Thank you. But there was a confusion. It was tough to do it because it wasn't.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Any further questions?
Oh.
Go ahead.
Okay. There was also a little bit of a question as to whether or not it's keeping in the neighborhood, and I wanted to make sure that you at least saw some representation. Here's two houses on Mill Pond Way that do have dual garages that are attached. Additionally, I went through the neighborhood on North Mill Pond and grabbed a couple other pictures of different houses. The one in particular on Clinton Street, the upper right-hand one, is similar to what I'm looking to do, which would be to make the garage and the porch align, with regards to a visual indication of what it might look like. So it is, the style is in keeping with the neighborhood, and I just wanted to reaffirm that. So the 208 Dennett is the one on the left that I have the arrow, because Petra definitely had concerns about where it would fall. 206 Dennett is actually on the right-hand side, so there's one window on 208 that does have a water view. It's kind of through my neighbor's at 61 Mill Pond Way, through her back garden, between her house and her garage that goes out to the water. And you know, although I know that views aren't protected, it is something I'm trying to make sure I can support her on this. That's why we adjusted the design. I do believe it's more of a seasonal view because there are about five big trees that are along that path as well. But you know, that is her view. And then 206 Dennett, I guess I could try the pointer here, which is this one. Her view goes right into my garage, and I actually have a picture of that as well. So this was when we met with Petra at 208, and we're trying to understand her view. This was like a day or two after the meeting. She affirmed that this was her view of the water. And so this is actually their garage. And then the porch is just beyond that, which is my porch. And then my husband's standing there with a post, which is where we were proposing our new garage line would be. And her water view, she had said, was over this lilac bush. And if you can kind of see it, it's right there. Now, this is the best view I could get because I wasn't allowed to go into the house to see what the view is from the second story, which is where she said she can see it from the one window on the second story. But that is what I believe to be her water view. And I believe with our new proposed design, which would align with the porch, we wouldn't infringe on her water view. Is there any questions on that?
Mr. Wright? No.
Yeah, I do have another question. I'm not sure if it will be addressed in another part of your presentation, but the building height of your addition, is that something you're going to be talking about?
Yep.
Okay. I'll wait then.
And this is Grace's water view at 206 Dennett. So that is actually my garage currently. So you can see that, and again, the setback's only like 5.5 feet, and that's the driveway for the neighbor that's down the, it's like the old Mason Road, right? So if by me pulling it forward, she's actually gonna have a much better view of the water because the garage won't be there. And the building height. So you can actually even count it in this if you really wanted to. You can count the building height because based on the boards. The boards on the barn or garage are 8 inches, and there are, I have this written down, there are 33 of them. So that, by the boards alone is 22 feet, and if you do the boards on the house, there are 77 of them at 4 inches, which is 25.5 feet, and then you just have to add the foundations for both and then the trim for both, and so they're about 3.5 feet difference in height today. And then the question about the height and the impact on the shadow and how the shadow would cast. So there's two things here. This was, I took this at 7 a.m. Right now that would be kind of the lowest that the sun would be in the sky. It comes from the rear of my house and a bit of an angle. So it comes over my neighbor that's behind me on 202 Dennett. And you can actually kind of tell from the peak here that that's where the shadow is. Keep in mind that the proposed design has this garage pulled forward, and so that means that the peak would be more towards this part of the garage, and it might be up a little bit higher because of it being 3.5 feet taller, but it would basically cast across their garage and not their house or their living space, which is here. And this is probably worst case scenario because this was 7 a.m. in the winter. And as the day goes on, the sun comes right over the house, and they have, you know, great afternoon sun. One of the other things that I did before I came here is I went around, because learning from my previous time at the, I collected some signatures from people. So I didn't hand them in when I handed the PowerPoint over, but I do have 6 signatures from people, and I have verbal okays from 3 other people. So I don't know if you want this. But.
You can just start down at the end.
Yep.
So I guess that was really all I had. I don't know if that answers your questions or concerns. I tried to address the shadow, the views, and the property value.
Are there any further questions from the board? Mr. Ringham?
So my concern was, I just wanted to validate. You had said that all your new structure, the maximum height is going to be the same as your existing,
yes.
Which you're giving at 28 feet, 5 inches, or 28 and a half feet. But in the 3-view renderings that you had provided to us, it certainly appears like the new structure is taller than your existing house.
It won't be. I mean, it's going to mirror it.
Yeah, just sort of taking a quick visual look at it.
Okay.
It certainly appears like it's ours. So I just want to validate completely that the intent is when this gets done that it's going to be symmetrical with the existing top of your
exactly.
House.
We actually built the house because of the way that the original garage looked to mimic that, and we wanted to basically keep that same sort of structure, same sort of design.
Thank you. Great.
Any further questions from the board? Mr. Parrott?
Just a question. In looking at the previous application, the new garage was dimensioned at 20 by 36.
Yeah, it was long and it's narrow.
Right. And the present proposal is 20 by 25, I believe.
It's a little bit, it's 30 because it's 20, the house is 24 and then this porch is 6. So it's the same depth as the house with plus the porch.
Okay, it says, it's 30 by 25, so.
Yep.
All right, so that's where the 5 feet addition is taken up by the closer, and the setback.
Correct.
And the previously was 10 feet.
Correct.
Proposed, and now
Correct.
It's, yep. Now it's 6 or 6 and a half, so.
Yeah.
Okay, my only other comment is that on the plan, what I call a builder's plan here, which is kind of hard to read. It shows the garage as looks like 20 feet. It's hard to read, but
yeah, it's 20 by 20 for the cars, and then there's a little walkway next to it.
20 feet wide. So you find when all is said and done that so this old plan is incorrect. It shows it 20 feet wide.
The one that I just submitted.
It's a machine copy of a machine copy, so it's not. It's labeled first floor proposed.
Yep.
And it, best I can read it, it looks like it's proposing a 20-foot wide garage.
For just the garage, the other parts is a connector to basically have another entryway.
Right.
Yep.
But on the table in the front, it doesn't say 20 feet wide. It says 25 feet wide.
Building. Yeah, that's the new structure. I guess if I should have just said just the garage, you're right, that just the physical parking for the cars would be 20 by 20 plus a little bit of a dent.
Okay, so this table is correct. Yeah.
Yes, the table is correct.
All right. Okay. Yeah, just the garage is just the garage.
Just the garage, just the parking for the garage.
Right. But yeah. You're including the 5 on this little connector, whatever it is.
Correct.
Okay,
for the entry.
Fine. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there any other questions?
Any other questions, Mr. LeMay?
Yeah, I'd like to follow up on Mr. Ringham's question regarding the garage height.
Yes.
I'm looking at both of these pictures that you've shown us.
Yeah.
And in both pictures, it appears that the ridge line of the garage is higher than the ridge line of the house by some substantial amount, and I'm wondering, and it also appears that the roof pitch is the same on the house and the garage, but because the garage is wider than the house, the top is going to be higher. So what's wrong? I think
it's just the way that this was drawn out on the computer, but I can guarantee you that it won't be any higher than the house.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Do you want me to turn this off then?
You can just leave that on that if you want. Is there anyone else in the public to speak in favor of the petition?
Hi, my name is Neil Snow. I own the property right across the street. It's 45 Mill Pond Way. And I don't have any issues at all with the all the renovations that she's been doing actually since she's moved there, actually has brought the value of our homes and the neighborhood up and has been keeping up with the look and feel of the neighborhood as well. So I'm all for replacing that barn with something new and updated.
Great. Thank you. Anyone else to speak in favor? Anyone to speak in opposition? Please come up.
My name is Petra Huda, and I live at 208 Dennett. And I don't have slides, so I'm going to actually give you pictures.
You can just hand them all down.
We'll pass them down. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I just like to start by clarifying some of the stuff that was on the BOA staff report. I did read through it, and I don't want any false interpretations by the data that was on there. So I'd, if you have your BOA staff report handy, on page 2, if you could please look at the aerial map of 40 Mill Pond Way, 2002. The map is not up to date on that map. The 206-208 Dennett Street is still showing an L-shaped building. In both views on that page, where actually it's a square, as noted in my sheets on the attached signed surveys, survey plat dated 6/12/2008. I don't know when this was taken from, but it had to be from before 2007 because the improvements were made at that time. Okay, I'll keep going. The next thing I want to call to your attention is on page 3, section E, the last sentence. The applicant has also met with the abutters to discuss their concerns. For me, I don't consider a meeting to discuss their concerns a brief conversation that Grace and I had as we were going out the door here at the last meeting. Both Grace and I explained the proposal for the garage and full second story the Coles had put forward would indeed block the view of Dennett Street. Further conversations with the Coles were next day when they were out measuring, they basically told me that this is where they were going to propose to put it, and you saw the pictures where Alistair was holding the sign up and saying this is where it's going to be. Again, I said no, and the only responses were, well, think about it, and this is only a seasonal view. After that, I did not really have any contact with the Coles. When I did see the resubmitted plans for the garage and the second story addition, I realized that the Coles were putting a balcony on the second story that would actually give them the view I currently enjoy. I would also like to address the application that was filed on the 12th of March. On the first page, Mrs. Cole is just requesting one variance for a setback when there still is actually three. Also on the second page, the top paragraph, it was not updated correctly. They both had still needed the request for three setbacks. I would also like to address the hardship section under section 1033 variance narrative. Granting the variance would not be contrary to public interest. The garage in the second story addition would go against public interest in that it still blocks, overshadows the light, airflow, water view of North Mill Pond by 208 Dennett and diminishes the value of the property as stated in the professional opinion rendered by Mr. Kurt Touche, a real estate agent for Keller Williams Coastal Realty of Portsmouth. And you can see the attached letter in your packet. Granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. The granting of these variances would not be in the spirit of the ordinance, as the garage and full second story addition are not consistent with the other single family structures on Mill Pond, on this section of Mill Pond Way. None of the other single family structures have a full second story over the garage, and several have a smaller footprint than the proposed addition. And you could see the labeled photos in there. I put three examples on Mill Pond in the packet. Granting the variance would do substantial justice. The Coles have not presented any documents of the current garage as reviewed by a structural engineer to warrant that the current building is structurally unsound. It does not meet It just does not meet their space needs at this time. Number four, granting the variance would not diminish the values of the surrounding properties. The application stamped on March 12th states the bordering building is a neighbor's garage and the variance would be to increase the distance between that building and the new structure. This is no longer applicable according to the new adjustment application. They were taking it, it previously was 10 as requested last time, and now it's moving out to 6.5, which is coming closer to the garage on Dennett Street. Unnecessary hardship test. I don't believe there's any unnecessary hardship for the Coles, as noted in section 10.33.30 through 10.33.70. The hardship would be incurred by 206-208 Dennett property owners on the section of North Mill Pond if this unconventionally large garage and second-story addition is allowed to move forward. Okay, and you could see the pictures of the current views from the second story of 208 Dennett, taken at a height of 17 feet, which would totally be obscured by the current proposal by the Coles and bring the garage and second floor addition forward to match their current home height of 28.5. Some other facts of note, if not addressed by the board. This entire application proposal is based on property sketches from tax maps, which clearly state that these are not provided by a professional surveyor and not legal or accurate representations of the listed property. Also, the Coles noted on the bottom map of number 02468 that the site map is not scaled correctly for the lot or existing structures, but the Coles submission is based on these maps where you could tell the sizes. And I would ask, how can we know what they are really proposing to build here if we can't use the maps that they're using to show us what they're doing? Another note, the Cole plans seem to be fluid. In the first meeting in February, the Cole stated there were no upstairs windows that would invade the privacy of the neighbors. I put in your package the sketch from the left side of the garage and the second floor addition. There appears to be three windows on both drawings that were submitted, and also on the sheet labeled living area on the proposed second story, which I've attached, there is three windows that appear. These windows would look down on the first floor of 206-208 Dennett and be in direct line with the second story windows. Please note that the adjusted application dated March 12th, 2014, after our discussion of the 206-208 Dennett concerns, also moves the garage and second story closer to 208 Dennett Street garage, further impairing all of the above mentioned obstructions. Do you have any questions?
Any questions from the board? Mr. Ream?
I just want to understand, if I could, your photos that you have of your water view. First of all, could you explain, I think, if I remember from the last meeting, is 208 broken up into two separate living units in that? Is that correct?
Yes, 206, which is owned by Grace Duke, and 208, which is mine.
Okay, and if you were facing it from Dennett Street, which one would be yours, the one on the left, is that correct? Or the one on the right?
Dennett Street. The one on the right.
Right, okay. So, and I'm just trying to understand this photo here. We have a roof that's fairly sort of in the foreground, and then another roof in the background. The roof in the foreground, is that the existing garage of your neighbor, or is that the garage that's actually on the 208?
Okay, are you on the picture, the one?
Yeah, they're not numbered, but it's entitled Project Obstruction of Water View 208.
Right, that the first garage is mine.
Okay.
That's the roof of mine. And then the where it says 28.5, that is the current height of the 40 Mill Pond property. So, I mean, you could clearly see if that's going to come out to above the tree, which you can see down at the bottom of the picture, mm-hmm. It will clearly obstruct any of the view.
So the roof that we're seeing in the background is currently the house that's owned by your neighbor that's making this application?
Yes.
Okay.
The one in the back, yeah.
So if they were to be moving that in the same plane as what currently exists, that would move that roof line closer, but would that cause it to then move further to the right, and as shown in this picture here? I'm trying to understand your concern with what they're proposing.
Well, what they're proposing is going to, if on a on the arrow where they're gonna end is, if you follow the arrow down, that is where it's gonna come out. So it will be, I don't know, maybe 6 foot longer than the end of my roof line, which would totally obstruct that view.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you. Is there anyone else to speak in opposition?
Hi, I'm Grace Duke. I own 206 Dennett. And 206, 208 Dennett is a condominium. We each own our half. So I'm just concerned about property values because as my neighbor's property value is diminished, that obviously hurts mine since they're identical units in the same house. That's it.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Any questions? No, thank you. Anyone else to speak in opposition?
Hi, my name's Kim Schroeder. I'm also an owner for 208 Dennett. And pretty much it would be redundant for me to go back over the points that Petra addressed. So I just wanted to say that I also oppose the proposal.
Thank you. Anyone else to speak in opposition?
Good evening. excuse me. George Dempsey, 42 Dennett Street. I came by this quite by accident, and I have reviewed the drawings, reviewed the site plan, right on down the line. I don't know how you can make a legitimate decision on this tonight. You can't read any of the measurements. The question to use a tax map, which I think everybody sitting here knows better, okay, the excuse that we can't get a surveyor when we've already been here once. There's a lot of questions here. And, you know, one of the problems in the city right now for all projects is people say things. Well, why are people saying something to you? If you have a legitimate survey, if you have legitimate architectural drawings that you can read, that are stamped, okay, survey drawings that are engineered and stamped, okay? And one of the things that concerned me when I saw some of the information was specifically stated that there would be no windows facing their property. That was said at the last meeting. All of a sudden, you now have windows. When you look at the pictures of the property, we're building a McMansion, okay? Look at the, you know, the area. If you look at Mill Pond Way, it's two sections. It's a 90-degree angle. This is the piece they live in, and then you have the monstrosities down the end of Mill Pond Way, okay, that don't fit in any place in Portsmouth. All I'm saying to you is, how do you make a decision on information that's incomplete, inaccurate, and really unfair? That's all I have to say. Any questions, I'd be happy to answer it.
Any questions from the board? Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a couple variances. Open it up for discussion or entertain a motion. And I'll comment that I do have some concerns with the size of this addition. As noted, there are many two-car garages in the area, but not many that are a full two-story in height. And part of the criteria for granting a variance is to look at there's a reasonably feasible alternative. And so when I look at the floor plans and look at the space, and to ask them to give up 3.5 feet of width in order to meet the side yard setback, you know, I look at the floor plans to see what they, you know, what rooms would be sacrificed, and Look, for example, on the second floor, there's two bedrooms up there and a bathroom, and one of the bedrooms appears to be 29 feet wide, which is one of the widest bedrooms that I've known of. It's drawn as one big room, the whole full width of the front face of the garage. If the garage is 30 feet, the inside's 29. So that's a very wide. I mean, I can easily see that giving up 3.5 feet of space. And then there's another bedroom. Looks like that could give up 3, and a very, you know, a nice sized bathroom. So it seems to me, with some reworking of the floor plan, the width of this could sacrifice 3.5 feet. I know where the main sacrifice or redesign needs to take place is on the first floor, where that secondary entrance probably needs to be combined onto that new front porch that they are proposing. So I understand there's a garage there now. It's of a certain height. But, you know, once you tear down something, you're supposed to try to meet all the criteria. And in this situation, to me, on the surface, it seems like there may be a reasonably feasible alternative. I think they will need even a redesign is going to need relief for the rear yard setback. I'm sympathetic to that, but I'm still haven't totally on board with the request for the side yard setback. And then in terms of the lot coverage, I think for the size of the lot and the shape, I think the request is, that seems reasonable to me, to be 30.9%. If the building was to shrink in width a little bit, they'd probably be in 28-29%, which is even closer to the requirement. So, can I have further discussion, or again, I'll entertain a motion?
Well, I'd just say there is some legitimacy to the comments made regarding the clarity of the siting of the property on the lot because of the, you know, because of the tax map issues and the clarity, readability, and lack of formal elevations for the building itself. It makes it a little bit of a reach to make a decision based on that, or to really record what the decision is, perhaps more than make the decision. I think the concept is not unreasonable of having an addition in that direction to make a garage and so forth, but I am sympathetic to the fact that it probably isn't quite there yet.
I'll add to the commentary as well, and I was a little concerned as well with the revised plans that we received. As has been pointed out, a lot of the dimensions are essentially unreadable. But even just taking a look at what was proposed before versus what is proposed now, I can kind of see what they ended up trying to have to do to the building to make it work by squishing it down. They sort of ended up making really some awkwardly shaped rooms. Even if I was to want to go and build that, I'm not sure that in the end you'd be really happy. And I have sort of this really long bedroom with this really long bathroom that sort of ended up being in there. I would concur with some of the comments that the chairman made, where I do think that you could get something that would have more realistic sized rooms, but shorten the addition up. There's a lot of discussion about tax maps versus surveying, and because of Portsmouth's the difficulty of getting surveys in Portsmouth, and we do generally recognize tax maps as being acceptable for many purposes, but when you do start getting into something where it gets more complicated, or you have a complicated shaped lot where we're now talking about you know, really encroaching on neighbors' properties where there might be concerns, it does behoove people. We've seen a lot of times where people come forth originally with just something related to a tax map, and then they do come back with a more detailed survey that really helps to put us at ease in terms of making sure that we really understand where these property lines are at. And I do understand the applicants tried to do the best that they could with, you know, just looking for their own markers and things like that, but professional surveyors do add that additional credence to what's being provided to us. So I would tend to agree as well. I mean, I do think that overall I think there's some potential for the addition to be added here. taking a look at the loss of views, again, with the angles, it's kind of tricky. I think you the neighbors are probably right in that there might be some loss of a view if there's a structure of the same depth at the height of the building. I'm not quite as sure that it is quite as much as what was being indicated. So I think we could maybe see something that would be smaller, but what is currently being proposed is probably not enough to satisfy all the criteria at this point in time.
Anyone like to make a motion to get this rolling?
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that the application that has been put forward be denied.
Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Your motion, please.
Yes. So I just provide some general commentary on what we're seeing here. Again, to pass before us, the application would need to meet all five of the criteria. To not pass, it would have to not meet one or more of the criteria. I do think here a couple of the ones where we're struggling is criteria number two, granting the variance would observe the spirit or the ordinance. Again, like we said, we're talking about an increase here from what's currently under the amount that's allowed. 25% is what's currently is allowed. The current one is showing at 23. They're looking to increase up to 30. Again, here we're that's a pretty substantial increase. I think we have some sympathy to some of the lot line setbacks. However, the one encroaching closer towards the neighbors on Dennett Street would probably be the most concerning. And I do think currently with what the applicant is proposing, that it's just a stretch a little bit too far beyond what would be in spirit of what we're trying to do with keeping light and air open relative to other properties and, you know, keeping some natural order and distance between properties in this zoning area. Second is the hardship. Again, I think it's probably the toughest criteria to meet. And I think it's failing here a little bit in that there's a desire by the homeowners to really, you know, maximize what they want to do here. But at the same point in time, we need to balance that against what the needs are of the surrounding properties and of the city as a whole. And I think here it's the tip of that balance is showing more towards the needs, the general public interest that's going on here versus the advantages that the homeowner is getting for making full use of their property. So based off of those two criteria, I don't think this application is worthy of being granted.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I agree with all the previous comments. I think this is one of those cases where a survey, which would be a very, very small percentage of the cost of extensive renovation like this, is in everybody's interest, particularly when you have buildings that are so close to each other and disparate in size and shape and so forth, in mass and so forth. And I think the design as proposed is fine in concept. I think it's probably not consistent with the public interest as in its present configuration, nor is it, to my mind, meet the spirit of the ordinance, which are very close to each other in the terms of the land use, because they're the first and second criteria, but they are combined now. So I don't think it satisfies either one as it is, but I think with redesign it certainly could satisfy that and make the project better for the homeowners and certainly better for the neighbors. So I think in this case, a redesign is and a survey is called for.
Any further comment from the board? Can I just comment to the applicant? I mean, don't get too discouraged. I mean, I think you're close. I think there's some support here for an addition. I think it's size sensitive and setback sensitive. This is a very large addition. We do regularly grant variances for setbacks for garages, but they're usually not of this size. So again, I think you're close. I think you know what you need to do. You know, continue some communications with your abutters, and you know, I wouldn't take this as a blanket denial and don't ever try to come back. So I think you know what's before you. So that said, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to deny. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been denied. Moving on to new business, case dash. First, I'm going to check to see, before I start that, if anyone is here for 75 Albany Street yet? No? Okay. Sorry about that.
I think you got one in the back here.
75 Albany Street? Are you the applicant? Okay. We are going to have, if I could just have you come up to the podium quick, please. Sorry, excuse me for jumping out of order here. I don't want him to wait all night. I'm sorry, go up to there.
I'm Andrew Ward with Colliers International. I'm the applicant's realtor.
Okay, so we are going to have 5 voting members for your petition. When we get to down to 5 voting members, you have the option of requesting a postponement because you still need 4 votes for a positive motion. So you have the option of postponing until next month, or we can still move forward tonight, and you would need 4 of the 5 votes.
Right. I spoke with the applicant's counsel, and we've both tried to communicate with the applicant, but I can't make that decision for him.
All right. Are you still in communications trying to get that?
Yeah, we are.
Okay. So for now, we're still on.
For now, we're still on.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Apologize for that. Okay, under new business, case 3-1, petition of Kathleen Calkins Trust, Kathleen Calkins Trustee, for property located at 206 Elwin Ave, Assessor Plan Map 112, Lot 27, in the Zoning District General Residence A. They're looking to replace an existing 178-square-foot rear addition with a 368-square-foot one-story addition. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 to allow a lawful non-conforming building or structure to be extended or reconstructed without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance, and also a variance from Section 10.521 to allow a building coverage of 31% where 27% exists and 25% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Hi, I'm Kathy Calkins. I grew up in Portsmouth, and my husband grew up in Newcastle. We went to Portsmouth schools and graduated from Portsmouth High School. I won't tell you what year. And we moved to Massachusetts and went to college there and got jobs and had our family. But we always wanted to come back to Portsmouth. Portsmouth is our home. It has a charm that no other place has, as you well know. And we were fortunate enough in 1995 to buy a house on Elwin Ave with the idea that we would retire there and stay there hopefully forever. We rented the house until 2005 when we were both ready and retired, and we moved here. And we absolutely love our house and our neighborhood. You know Elwin Ave, it's very eclectic. It's a true Portsmouth, a bunch of mishmash houses all kind of jammed in on odd-shaped pieces of land with a trillion dogs that don't match and a trillion people that don't match. And we love that. It's a neighborhood with older people, young people, lots of families, and it just makes us feel young to live there. It's a true pleasure. The only drawback to the house is we don't have a bathroom on the first floor, and that is getting to be more and more of a drawback. It's a drawback for us if we want to stay there forever, which we do. It's a drawback in the sense that we can't have our older family members come and visit without a bathroom on the first floor. It's a handicap. It's also a handicap now that our friends are getting older, because we can't have them for dinner if they have to go upstairs and the stairs are steep to the bathroom. So for those reasons, we're asking you for a variance to put on take off the old porch on the back of our house, which does not have a foundation and is not heated. It's just kind of a shell of a back porch. And we'd like to take that off, put on a room in the back, and a three-quarter bath. And if we are allowed to do that, then we're all set, and we'll be there forever and ever. And thank you very much. And we also have our contractor here if you have technical questions, because I would not do that well.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any questions from the board? Mr. Raymond?
I do have a question. I don't know if you or your contractor want to answer them.
This is Gordon Murray. He's our contractor.
Okay, great.
I'm Gordon Murray. How are you doing?
Good, thank you. So, and we were just trying to understand, too, typically when we have an addition, we do get some kind of a floor plan layout of what the addition is going to contain. So it does sound like from the applicant that it contains a bathroom, but I'm presuming there's some other things that are going on there in addition to that?
It's going to be a sunroom and a bathroom. It's just two rooms.
Okay. It's a fairly, you know, decent-sized addition for just adding, like, a bathroom. So I'm just trying to understand what the floor plan would look like in there. Maybe you could just describe it in general.
Yeah, as you exit the house and head towards the back, it would be one long room in front of you, and off to the side would be a long bathroom.
Okay. And it looks like the request is for 368 square feet of total addition, which includes this new addition of 295 square feet. And then there's also some description of a side porch and a doghouse as part of this application.
The doghouse is the entry to the cellar. That was what the architect called it. It's an architectural term. Right. It's a bulkhead with a roof.
Okay. Where is the side porch? Is that we kind of have this illustration here.
Okay, if
I'm
you're looking
trying to understand
that,
what the side porch is that's being described.
If you look at that illustration, you'll see over to the left there's a set of steps coming up.
Yep.
That's the side porch.
Okay.
Just the steps coming up to that landing, and then there's a door there to enter.
All right, and so that's all brand new part of that as well. Okay.
Yeah. There's a set of steps there now and an entry there now that we're going to tear off and just rebuild it.
Okay. So in my elevation view that you've added in here, so the doghouse is this extension piece here.
Yeah, it's that door you're looking at.
Okay, right, and that goes down?
That goes down into the cellar. It's going
to
be
the
cellar.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Any further questions from the board? Mr. LeMay?
Is there a roof over the side porch?
There is. There's a the roof over the structure continues down over the side porch.
Okay. Mr. Parrott?
Excuse me. As Mr. Riom said, this the information is kind of sketchy here. What does this involve? A complete removal, tear down of the addition.
It does.
Hanging there now. Okay.
Yeah, complete removal.
Okay. And what's the dimensions of the replacement?
The new addition is going to be 19 by 15 and a half, and then the side steps will be 15 by 3, and then that little cellar entry is about 6 3/4 by 4 feet.
So is the width of it across the back of the house the same as it is now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it will come into the backyard how much further?
About eight more feet.
Eight more feet.
Okay. Right now it comes out 8 feet, and it's going to come out about 8 more feet.
Excuse me. Okay. Okay. All right. I know it's obvious. It's okay. But what is the height of the new addition going to be?
It's going to be 6 inches higher than the existing one. So
okay.
The whole thing's about 12 feet with,
about 12,
the, with the foundation.
To the ridge?
Yeah, to the ridge. It's 6 inches higher than the existing one.
Okay, 6 inches higher and 8 feet further into the backyard, and the same width, and it's strictly one floor?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Any further questions, Mr. Raum?
I do have one more clarification. So taking a look at this, again, this general plan view that you provided, there is showing a dimension to the side yard line of 11 feet to the existing. But the new addition continues on further, as we've noted, and the property line is kind of going towards the house. So I just want to make sure, at the very extreme end of the new addition, are you confident that it is 10 feet or greater to the property line at that location when you guys get done?
Yes.
All right.
Any further questions? None. Thank you. Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition?
Evening. My name is Alan Lincoln. I own and live at 224 Elwin Avenue, which is one house away from the Calkins. I support their request for a variance. In fact, I believe this is exactly the kind of issue that variances are meant to alleviate. A small change in lot coverage, allowing a bathroom and room on the first floor, will enable the Calkins to remain in their home as they age. Our driveway uses Sherburn Avenue, and I pass by the back of the Calkins house several times a day. Given the current structure of the home and the landscaping, the slightly increased size of the new addition would barely be noticeable, if at all. There's a sizable backyard, plus a town-owned buffer of land between the street and the house. It should have absolutely no negative impact on us as abutters. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you. Anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a lot coverage variance. I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
A motion, please.
I think this is pretty simple. It's a small a small increase with no impact to the significance to the abutters of the city, and it cures a functional obsolescence in the property given its age. I think that it fits in with the lot. It does not change the neighborhood. It is not contrary to the public interest. And I believe it observes the spirit of the ordinance, if not strictly. The variance is small, looking for a couple percent additional lot coverage while meeting sideline setbacks and so forth. This will do substantial justice. It'll allow the house to be used in a more up-to-date way. Allow the owner to continue the enjoyment of the property. It won't diminish the values of surrounding properties. It doesn't encroach on light and air. There's already a single-story addition there. This just blows it out a little bit. And clearly, the strict application of the law would cause a substantial hardship for this applicant. So for those reasons, I think we should approve.
Thank you. Your second?
I would incorporate Mr. LeMay's comments into my own and just add, when I looked at this, I mean, it is pretty straightforward and a very reasonable request. The only difficulty I had was with the hardship test. Usually that's something inherent in the land. I'm not here. You are dealing with a long, narrow lot. You are dealing with a non-conforming structure that already exists on a long, narrow lot. Aside from that, we can consider when somebody's trying to make improvements to a property to make it handicap accessible. For those reasons, I think that the applicant has met that test, so I'm in support of the motion to grant the variance.
Thank you. Any further comment? Hearing none, a call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Ayoub?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
LeMay?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Petition has been granted.
Thank you.
Good luck with that. Moving on to case 3-2, the petition of DEH Ventures LLC owner and CHI engineer and applicant for property located at 430 West Road, Assessor Plan Map 267, Lot 28, in the Zoning District Gateway. They're looking to install two roofed heating air conditioning units on 12-foot by 6-foot pads and add 21 off-street parking spaces in front of the building. This will require a variance from Section 10.531 to allow a front yard parking setback of 27.6 feet where 30 is required, a right side yard setback of 12.5 feet where 30 feet is required, and a variance from Section 10.1112.50 to allow 127 off-street parking spaces where a minimum of 77 is required and a maximum of 85 is allowed. Finally, a variance from Section 10.1113.20 to allow off-street parking to be located in the front yard or between the principal building and a street. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Good Hi, good evening. My name is Mark Eaton, and I'm the general manager for CHI Engineering. I represent the principal owners that have the DEH Ventures. We are an engineering company, been here for a few years. We have the fortunate grace of growing. We're hiring a lot of engineers. So we have run out of space, and we've met before the building department, and they granted us a building permit to build within the building, which that structure is almost complete. One thing we sort of thought of, but really didn't get into the nitty-gritty until we realized where we're going to put the air handlers for the heating and cooling. We have a slope roof. It can't go on to the slope roof. The current weight load on the existing office is too much, so we were going to put it inside, and my consultant here, Jerry Cody, who's here this evening, if there's any technical questions, came to see the planning department and kind of talked about some ideas. And one of the ideas, unbeknownst to Jerry, that I thought about putting on the west side of the building behind the trees on that ring-around driveway on Water Country side. And I think the planning department said that probably is a reasonable approach, but you've got to go before the board for a variance. So we're proposing to put a couple of pads, cement pads, just tucked next to the building so we can just pipe it into the structure to heat and cool the new inside addition. That's the first one. I had two separate variances, and talking to the folks in the planning department, they thought it'd be best to present both of them. We do have a request for 21 additional spots touching the existing driveway in the front, fully willing to give up parking that's been approved on a site plan, I think back in 03 or 04, into the back to satisfy the variance for parking in total. So with that, I'm open for questions.
But we never thought we'd have someone come before us willing to take away parking to meet the requirements.
Yeah, I did submit an aerial photo that kind of helped you. I thought it was important to see it visually, what it might look like, if that helps you at all.
Okay. Are there any questions from the board, Mr. Rayum?
Well, just to prove that we're never happy. So the spaces that you're proposing to give up to, so that variance would actually go away, they're currently unmarked in a gravel area. Is your intent just to continue to leave that as a gravel area or to do something different with that space?
Leave it as gravel. What we discovered as we've been hiring more engineers and more support staff, mm-hmm. you know, people parking in the backside and walking through the lot, it doesn't make sense. So we got the land up front. Can we plead our case and say it makes sense to park up front? So yes, we would leave it gravel and revert it back if we had to.
Okay.
To satisfy either any requirements.
My understanding, the basis for the ordinance of the maximum number of parking spots is to make sure that we don't create seas of asphalt where we really don't need them. But in here, admittedly, you have a gravel space, but the other plus to our ordinance on maximum number of spaces is to encourage green space and making sure that we maintain sure. tree lines and
understood
lawn areas and things along those lines. I didn't know if you had any feeling one way or another if that was required to be, turned over to become green space of some sort or, brought back to its natural state. Would that be an issue for you or a hardship?
Not at all. We've been putting just equipment and a couple trailers and out there. It's kind of high grass. Now it abuts the Water Country back mm-hmm. Field. But people have been parking kind of on there to get in the building because we're really getting cramped for space.
Right.
So we're trying to alleviate that hardship by saying, listen, we can give up that land for official parking space and move it up the front. And we're willing to do that and revert that back to green space if required.
Okay. And my only concern there is just, you're right. I mean, otherwise it's sort of just a paper exercise where it's still basically available parking. You're just not going to call it parking anymore. I guess some of the other board members might have a little bit more concern about that.
Sure.
So,
talking with the planning board, if that particular part of the variance is approved, I have to come back to the planning board with a full-blown review for that parking, and we have no problem doing that. So.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions from the board? No, thank you.
Okay.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a couple of variances. for some parking, and heat and AC pads, the roof. I'll just comment that the requirement for not allowing parking between the front of the building and the street was part of the whole Gateway District and developing certain streetscape along Route 1 and any new development. I don't feel it was specifically geared for hooking in around behind West Road and an industrial park with buildings that already exist. So I understand the desire to have that section of the ordinance, and you know, it was enforced with the development at Yokins, and it makes sense there, but I'm not sure it specifically applies to this property as it's located. I just feel like the lot in front of it, between it and Route 1, is so narrow that the district grabbed this property almost by default.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I'd like to encourage some discussion on my point about the gravel area behind the building, if the rest of the board, anyone has any opinions on whether or not it's suitable just to leave that as gravel, or if something different should be done with it.
Mr. LeMay?
Well, I like the idea of trading off green space for green space, but I don't feel it's necessary to go into, I mean, enormous renovation of that gravel area since it serves the purpose. I just would want to see it all become parking. You know, in other words, giving up some of those spaces is not a bad thing. It's more of a shift then we're looking at a shift rather than an addition of spaces.
So are you comfortable with gravel, or do you want to see green space?
I can live with it.
Live with the gravel?
I think they ought to put a nice grass and an employee picnic table, but, okay. You know.
A little bocce court or something?
Yeah.
And this will also go before site plan review, and maybe we could maybe not specifically make a stipulation if we don't want, but we could make a comment for site plan review if we so.
Yeah, that would do.
Feel inclined to do that. Would anyone like inclined to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that we approve as presented and advertised, with the exception that variance number 2 not be granted, and that the applicant proceed forward with their plan to move the identified parking spaces from the rear of the property to the front of the property and eliminate parking in the rear, which would then negate the need for that variance.
Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
All right, your motion, please.
Thank you. So we've had some general discussion on it. I think overall this is a decent proposal. Again, with the moving the parking to the front, it's a more logical location to support employees entering the premises. There is already some existing parking at the front of the building, so the fact that we're adding some more between it and West Road is perhaps less of a concern than it might be if this was a brand new lot that is being put into the front of the building. As the chairman has already pointed out, I think there's the requirement that was put forward that's in the zoning ordinance in regards to the parking being in the front of the building really is for aesthetics along our gateway corridor, a little less so for a side road like West Road, and even along the gateway corridor. We've already had a few instances of applications that have come before this board where we've already granted exceptions to it, just because it is very difficult in practice to fully adhere to every aspect of that requirement. So the other issue would be the encroachment of the proposed air conditioning units on the side property line. There is also a front yard, the right side yard setback for that of 12 and a half feet, where 30 feet is required. So that is about half of what is normally called for, but this is sort of a unique situation where they're really abutting a property that is a very, very large property. It's not like this is in the South End where we've had some applications and people are right up next to other people's homes. There's really nothing over there other than a road. It's the Water Country property. So Overall, I don't see a lot of negative impact to anyone living on that other side. So I think that makes that, this particular application makes that a bit more palatable in terms of meeting the spirit of the ordinance. So going through the criteria in detail, granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest. Again, the public interest here, as I indicated, especially on the front side, parking is to maintain a gateway corridor appearance that is free of cars in front of the buildings, less of a concern here. So the public does not have an interest there. And then the interests of the public in regards to the side setback are minimized by the absence of any structures over there and the nature of the lot that's going on there. Granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. Again, I've covered some of the reasons why that's the case. Granting the variance would do substantial justice. Again, this allows the applicant to make more logical use of their property by placing additional parking up in front that is of benefit to their employees, their expanding company, which is a positive thing for the community. And in terms of air conditioning, it's pretty much a generally expected ability to have a fully air-conditioned office space. As the applicant has indicated, they do have some hardship in that respect in terms of trying to place this. Perhaps a little bit more thinking up front would have given them an opportunity to put it on the roof or something, but there's also disadvantages to that in the sense that now any sound that's being generated by that is casting probably a greater distance, whereas here by placing it down on the ground, even if it is close to a property line, it's perhaps more hidden by both the building and trees. So in that sense, I think there's substantial justice being done here. Granting the variance would not diminish the values of surrounding properties. Again, this is a generally industrial area. What they're asking for here is not out of character with other properties in the area, and would generally probably, if anything, increase this combined with all the other things that they're doing that's associated with these variances would tend to increase the overall value of their property and therefore most likely other similar properties in the area. And then our hardship test. So there is special conditions on the property. Basically, you have a building that is set up fairly close to a property line. There is the unique hardship here that they have mentioned where the structure of their building really does not allow them to place the air conditioning units up on top of the building. There's also the unique circumstance where they do currently have parking in the front and want to move that a little bit closer to the West Road end. And again, being dictated by the situation, siting of their current building on their lot. So I do think there's some hardship here. And then there is really no fair and substantial relationship between the general public purposes of the ordinance and this specific application, and the proposed use is a reasonable one in both cases. So I think it meets that criteria as well.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with what Mr. Ayoum just said, and I would just add that there's lots of good reasons for that requirement that parking be restricted between the principal building and the road, but in this case, I think it's illogical to waive that requirement because West Road number one is lightly traveled. You can't even see, this property is kind of tucked away from the traffic, main traffic, which is on Lafayette Road. It's buffered by a building in front and it abuts a seasonal parking lot in the back. There's quite a bit of vegetation buffer around front and back. And there aren't any houses anywhere near. This is kind of a bit of an odd district, actually. So it's commercial or at least non-residential, even across the street. So I think this is a logical place to waive that requirement. And the lot doesn't provide a lot of places for the equipment that they need to provide. And by taking away the parking on the back, probably gaining a little bit of open space. Just left as gravel. So I think for all those reasons, it's in the public interest and that we should grant this waiver.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board?
I'll just say it did not make it a stipulation that the back gravel area be converted back to green space, but I would encourage the applicant to strongly consider it when they move this forward to the planning board for approval.
Okay. Any further comment? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to grant variances under part one and part three, not to grant. This motion does not include the variance request number two, which assumes that the applicant will remove the parking in the rear, and that comments should be made to the planning board to consider green space in lieu of the gravel area in the back. That said, I'll call for a vote. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. The petition has been granted. I will briefly look at to Mr. Ritchie's realtor for a thumbs up or down. Okay, thumbs up. We will be hearing 75 Albany Street at the end of the evening. Moving on to case 3-3, petition of Donovan Hess Family Revocable Trust, Jane Donovan, William Hess Trustees, property located at 54 Rogers Street, Assessor Plan Map 116, Lot 44, in the Zoning District Mixed Residential Office. They're looking to install a 12.5-foot by 8.5-foot shed in the left rear yard. This will require a variance from Section 10.521 and 10.572 to allow a 1-foot 7-inch left side yard setback where 10 feet is required for an accessory structure. Variance from Section 10.521 and 10.573.20 to allow 1-foot 8-inch rear yard setback where 10 feet is required for an accessory structure. And a variance from Section 10.521 to allow building coverage of 42% where 38% exists and 40% is a maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
I'm Bill Heston. I live at 54 Rogers Street. A couple of years ago, we had submitted an application for some work that we had done to our house to put an addition on. Part of that application was also to add a shed. At the time, we did not pursue adding the shed during that construction. So now we are coming back, and we have submitted an application to build a shed. We have changed the size. We've made it a little bit smaller, and we have turned it about 90 degrees from the way it was sitting on the lot before. Otherwise, it has the same setbacks as before. I think that's about it.
So the previous, when you did the addition on the house, you were granted a variance for that, and part of that variance process included a shed that was never built?
Correct.
Right.
We had a garage on the lot.
Right.
We removed the garage. I think that was 12 by 20.
Right. And this isn't that generally same footprint as the garage that was removed?
Yes.
Okay. So from what was previously approved, you're requesting a smaller shed turned 90 degrees?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yeah, I just want to understand, and I'm not sure if you have the answer, maybe I might need Juliet. Back in 2008, there was talk about the board granting variances to create an addition that would have resulted in lot coverage up to 46%. Was that never carried out? Is that why we currently have lot coverages that are less than that number?
I'm not sure the answer, but this may be related to the fact that there was some question about the size of the lot in a dispute with the lot line. Remember, there was a correction with the city regarding the lot line that you referred to, the easement, so forth.
Where we bought the driveway back?
The school department, yeah. So I'm wondering if that affected the coverage at that point.
I honestly don't know.
That's my only response to that, is I haven't actually looked into that, but that may be that there was some discrepancy in the lot, and that was resolved before you applied in 2012, correct?
So we're confident
we did resolve it before we applied.
Okay. And I just want to make sure, absolutely sure, that 42% is in fact the correct number. We got a lot of different numbers going on here.
The 42 is correct, and it's actually what was presented previously, the building coverage that was applied for in the 2012 application.
Okay.
Any further questions from the board? None. Thank you.
Thanks.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a shed where previously located garage was once located. We'll entertain a motion.
I move to approve.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion, please.
Seeing this was pretty much something going in where existing shed was, and we're really maybe not replacing in kind, but very close to in kind, I see this as very little change in lot coverage and building coverage. I'll just go through the criteria to get it soon. Granting this would not be contrary to the public interest. I don't see this as anything changing public interest, seeing that no one was here from the public. I think this is a very small adjustment. Granting this variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. Again, this is a request by the applicant. Been a long day to make this adjustment, and I think this is the spirit of the ordinance. Granting this variance would be substantial justice. I believe that it would do substantial justice and allow the applicant to enjoy this property and take on what he originally planned for the property. Granting this variance would not diminish values of surrounding properties. This is a shed. The existing shed, though we didn't hear about it prior to the one they took down, may have not been the most attractive shed. I believe the shed will certainly improve the property. And the unnecessary hardship is that he needs storage on his property, and I'm sure the shed will provide that.
Thank you. Your second?
I'm not sure I have anything to add. I'll concur with the comments.
Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Ayoum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Your petition has been granted. Case 3-4, 303 Islington Street has been requested to be postponed. Move on to case 3-5. Petition of Christoph Winans and April Wheel. Hope I said that right. Property located at 307 Wybird Street, Assessor Plan Map 132, Lot 12, in the Zone District General Residence A. We're looking to construct a 26-foot by 26-foot two-story rear addition. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 to allow a lawful non-conforming building or structure to be extended or reconstructed without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Variance from Section 10.521 to allow a left side yard setback of 9 feet 5 inches, where 10 feet is required, and a building coverage of 26.3%, where 18.1% exists, and 25% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
My name is Amy Dutton. I'm the designer on the project, and this is Christoph.
Hi, I'm Christoph Wienans, the owner, one of the owners.
April is at home with the babies. So just as a description of the project, the house is a modest size in downtown Portsmouth. I'm located at 307 Wybird. We are seeking an addition and renovation in order to accommodate the family, a growing family's needs of a family room repair, and there's an existing addition that runs along the side that we need the variance on, which is already 9 feet 5 inches from the property line. What we'll do is take down that wall and use the existing foundation wall and continue that out. This will create a space that will hold a family room, mudroom, laundry, pantry, and much needed kitchen renovation. On the second floor, there will be master bedroom suite with a home office and a relocated existing bathroom that is already in the existing location that will be relocated. The existing bump out that is there right now is in much need of repair with freezing pipes. So to address the variances 10.521 and 10.324, the variance is not contrary to the public interest. The addition and renovation to the structure is not in any way altering the neighborhood. The neighborhood is typically New Englanders with small additions onto them, and we're staying in keeping with basically what all of the neighbors and neighborhood has already established. The spirit of the ordinance will be observed in that it is not our intention to be harmful to health and safety and welfare of the public. The Venans have spent an incredible amount of sweat equity and time in removing mold and issues that were harmful over a period of 3 years, five years. So this is sort of their last chance to finish up the house and make it safe for their family. Substantial justice will be done as we look at the current issues in the home and protect the public interest in these improvements. The values of the surrounding properties will not be diminished. Both neighbors directly to the right and left have already done significant projects. In great respect to that, we have taken the what you see from the front elevation, the right property line on the second floor. We moved back the master bedroom suite, moving it away from the neighborhood. Neighbors do not physically overwhelm them in light and in air and in presence. The property on the left hand side, it will be very hard to see that addition, and you can more see that best from the drawings and the photos supplied. The initial enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would result in hardship, unnecessary hardship. This is always the tricky one, isn't it? The Venans have spent their substantial time in the house doing a ton of work and improving the house. And what we're looking for is an opportunity to create a home for them that is comfortable and it suits their needs. We have not tried in any way to over design it and to overextend the footprint. They literally have measured their strollers so that we know that they just fit in the mudroom without anything else in there, including a closet or a bench. And that's really what dictated what was happening in the footprint. The lot is already non-conforming, and the side setback is also a non-conforming side that we're just trying to continue on. It does have plumbing and electrical that already runs through there. The electrical does need to be upgraded as well as the plumbing, but we're trying not to incur any more unnecessary costs.
Regarding the neighbors, as Amy already mentioned, on both sides they've already done additions, actually approximately in the same size, at least on one side, as we are doing. From the sight lines, as you can see, we're trying really hard to make this look nice. What we're trying to avoid at all costs really is a long straight 50-foot wall, because that would not fit the neighborhood, we believe, where we're letting in more light. By setting the second story back. Regarding the size, we've already, with what we'd really like to have, like a little pantry, a powder room downstairs, a utility room for laundry and a mudroom, plus the family room, which is really the main part that we want to put in there. We've already narrowed down everything as much as possible. For example, 5 foot width for a bathroom. You can't really go much lower than that, otherwise it's not conforming anymore. Our mudroom isn't even 5 foot large anymore. So from a coverage size, I think we're we try to get it down as much as possible. Regarding the setback, as Amy mentioned, we'd like to continue the existing wall of the wall of the existing addition. That one is tied into already finished space that we've already renovated. If we had to move that by half a foot, we'd have to start move again, touch ripping up already finished space, moving doors into behind other doors. So that's I can't think of anything else.
All right, so I just have one question. I think you've kind of answered, is that the request for 9 feet 5 inches where 10 is required, there's already an addition there. How far does that project, that addition project towards the backyard?
Projects out 11 feet.
11 feet. Okay. So you're going to go an additional 15 feet off of that line?
Right. Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Let me just see which one. We're talking about.
I think the upper left photo shows it there. Yeah.
Okay. There are no large windows for major view or so.
Okay. Any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
I just have one, I guess. So the side setback, I think I think there's some pretty good justification for in terms of there's an existing addition there, so you're sort of building off that foundation line. But the lot coverage, 26.3%. I know you're only asking for 1.3% more, but at the same point in time, is there any way that you could have gotten 1.3% less just so that we wouldn't have to worry about that variance? It does, you know, from a hardship standpoint, you have a pretty big lot. Could you just live with that 1.3% less? And if you can't, what specifically in the design? Because I'm looking at some of the things you have on the first floor in terms of the laundry space and some other things. What wouldn't work in that space if you were to lose 1.3%?
So 1.3% is in the range of 100 something square feet, considering a right now as we've designed it, well, what is it like 1300? So what we're talking about approximately 10% of the first floor space then that we would have cut down, and that, for example, is a utility room and a mud room and a little bit extra space, so to extend the kitchen, to put an island in. If we had to cut down by these 100 something feet, it would be a significant loss with what we're envisioning right now. Cut down the family room by half, or lose these extra rooms there that we have. Considering the lot size is approximately 1.5 acres, so I feel it is a small lot. I mean, for that, oh, sorry, 0.15, yeah. In the neighborhood, it's probably somewhat a little bit below average. There are smaller lots, not that many. There are a number of larger lots, so we would really have liked to avoid that, but as I said, we've already designed with inches, and felt this was like the minimum that really made sense for us.
Okay.
There was some confusion between what.
Can you just make sure you speak into the microphone, just so we get it.
There was some confusion as we were designing and running numbers between what the town had and what their neighbor survey had, and they didn't. We're trying to not incur a cost of having it surveyed because it is literally by 150 feet. It's literally inches, and I think that was initially a miscalculation. And, you know, poor Juliet, at the very last minute, we were trying to figure out, are we over, are we not over, because it was that close.
Mm-hmm. So one question for you. Do you know when you were putting that calculation together, did the front steps, were they part of?
They are so in there, yes.
They're in there. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Any other questions from the board? Mr. Parrott?
Yeah, speaking of the size of the lot, what? The site plan doesn't actually have the dimensions of the lot. What is the width?
The width is 100 and
I have a
there's several. That's one. That's a site plan that his neighbor had surveyed.
What would you like to see that?
Which is actually different than what the town has.
I mean, so in the front, I have so from a survey, from Easterly survey, it is 45 in the front and 46 in the back.
Okay. That's what we have on our lot coverage.
And they and then 146.5 on the side and 148 on the so we were it's a little
I was trying know. To the reason I was asking I was trying to add up some of the excuse me the setbacks and the numbers of the additions and they weren't coming out quite closely but the closest I got was 45, maybe a little shy, on the particularly towards the front. Okay, so that's consistent with what you're working with.
Yes.
Are you pretty sure of the sideline? Pretty sure where the sidelines are.
So one comes off of a survey, and the other one, the 148, I measure personally.
Okay. Consistent with the tax map.
The tax map has 150.
Okay.
150 on one side and 145 on the other.
No, I'm just the width. I'm just concerned about not the length, not the depth.
You're concerned about the 45 and
right.
the 46.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Those seem to be consistent, but the 150 and 148.5 are not consistent with what the town has or what he's measured, which is not necessary.
That's not. Yeah. The 45 is the width is probably of more concern in this case. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. For that side setback.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a side yard setback and lot coverage in order to construct a rear addition. We'll entertain a motion or open up for some discussion.
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that we approve the request as presented and advertised.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Your motion, please.
Yes. So overall, I think what is being proposed here is pretty reasonable. It's a good size addition, there's no doubt about it, but from the standpoint of the fact that we're most of this is within what the property owner has within their rights and in full compliance with the zoning ordinance, the exceptions that are being asked for here are relatively small and I think meet the criteria as I'll explain going forward. Granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest. So overall, we're talking about a neighborhood that has quite a number of homes. I did have an opportunity to go around the neighborhood a little bit on Monday. You can definitely see where many other similar homes in the neighborhood have had additions added onto them over time. Maybe not as recent as this one, but you can definitely see that similar size were roughly in scale with what's being requested for here. Types of additions are fairly prevalent in a number of the homes in the neighborhood. There's really nothing, all the addition is in the back part of the house. It appears to be overall from all the information that's been provided to be in keeping with the general style of the house from circa 1905. So in that sense, I think the public interest is served and that this is not something that would add a different dimension to this neighborhood or cause something that we haven't seen before. Granted variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. Overall, what's being requested for here is pretty minor relief. The 9 feet, 5 inches, basically 9.5 feet versus the 10 feet is required for the side yard setback. Overall, the half a foot is very small relative to what's there and has some basis for in the current addition for asking for it. And again, the lot coverage, 26.3%, 1.3% over. I did, you know, make some inquiries from the applicant. Is it possible to squeeze it down? And looking at the floor plans, I could see where, you know, maybe you could shave off a couple feet here or there, but it would start to perhaps seriously impact the overall look of the addition and some of its utility and usefulness. Next criteria is granting the variance would do substantial justice. Again, this would give this homeowner the opportunity to make an expansion on really when you see this house in person, you kind of realize it is sort of odd shape, short in its shortness of the main original house, sort of very tall but very short. So from a perspective of modern houses, you generally want, you know, a lot of first floor space, especially for, you know, a larger kitchen, which is more common with families now. And this also gives them the opportunity for that family room on the rear portion of the building. So really, looking at the overall layout of the building, what it gives for additions, additional space for the homeowner, it makes it more incompatible with a home of this century as opposed to one of the beginning of the prior century. So in that sense, I think it meets the substantial justice criteria. Granting the variance would not diminish the values of surrounding properties. Again, this addition would most likely end up increasing certainly the value of this property, and there's almost always a trickle-down effect on surrounding properties that you would have an increase in value. In terms of imposing on the other neighboring properties, looking at it, I did have a chance to look at the neighboring properties on either side. It's not like there's already homes that extend very far back on their lots. You're not talking about an addition that would, you know, dwarf something immediately right next to it. So I don't see where any of the immediately adjacent properties would probably suffer from this addition. Rather, they would benefit overall from the increase in property values. Finally, the hardship test. There are a couple special conditions that distinguish it from other properties in the area. One of the things that I did key on was the front stairway, which this property, the way it's situated, is up on hill. This stairway is absolutely necessary to gain access to the property. That does figure into the calculation for the total lot coverage. So in a sense, you could say that this house has a hardship and is being penalized by its, sort of its site on this hill, and the nature of that does take up some of the lot coverage that would otherwise be available for this addition. So not quite sure if it meets the 85 square feet that is represented by the 1.3%, but it certainly brings us a lot closer. And then in terms of the side setback, we do have an existing addition that runs along there, so it does make logical sense to make use of that foundation space and continue on with that same line. So I think, again, that's another hardship related to the existing conditions of this property that can be represented here, and there's really nothing in the public interest that would outweigh those two hardships in granting this.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with Mr. Rayum's comments, and I would just add that this addition is well designed, and when it comes right down to it, the relief that's being requested is really pretty small, and thirdly, that's certainly not going to be any detrimental effect to any of the neighbors that I can see. So I think for all those reasons, it satisfies the criteria, and we should pass it.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Urban?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
LeMay?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. We need to step back for 1 second. I neglected to take a quick vote on the request for postponement on 303 Islington Street due to the fact we had 5 voting members. Mr. Rayum will be recusing. If I could get a quick.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
And a second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And now we'll do the same for 159 Middle Street, request and postponement due to the fact 5 voting members. So, Mr. Durbin will be recusing himself.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
That has been postponed also. That will move us on to case 3-7, petition of Peter and Lee Vandermark, property located at 86 Ridges Court, assessor plan map 207, lot 62, in the zoning district single residence B. They're looking to raise the height of an existing left side shed roof. This will require a variance from section 10.321 to allow a lawful non-conforming building or structure to be extended or reconstructed without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Variance from section 10.521 to allow a left side yard setback of 5.25 feet where 10 feet is required. Is there anyone here to speak to the petition?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and the board. My name is Matt Bano. I'm a designer. I'm working for the Vandermarks. They are out of town. I think this is pretty straightforward. We're looking for relief from section 10.321 and 10.521. The Vandermarks would like to raise the roof on an existing portion of the building that's in the side setback currently. The style will remain the same. Would you like me to speak to the basic points of the variance approval?
Or? If you could just quickly note how much higher the roof is going to be raised.
That will be, if you look at the section, essentially about 3 feet at the high point against the house.
Okay, 3 feet at the high point, a little lower as you get towards the property line?
A bit lower.
Okay, thank you. Okay, you can address the criteria.
As to the variance being not contrary to the public interest, it's not going to alter the essential character of the neighborhood or threaten public health or safety. The spirit of the ordinance is observed in that the proposed expansion, it's minimal, does not alter the basic existing use of this lawful non-conforming structure. It's not a material change, and it shouldn't affect the general public. To substantial justice will be done, and that the benefit to the owner derived from the proposed alterations will have no adverse impact on the general public. It should not affect the value of any abutting properties. There's only really one abutter. It's on the south side. We actually have an email from that abutter who is in support of that. And then as to hardship, the existing configuration of the space, it's a living room. I would say the homeowner's been in there at least 20 years, but it has sort of this sunken living room that is the full width of the living room with two risers down to it. And essentially they want to bring that up so that it's one level, so that they have had some tripping incidents over the years with friends and family, and it just would be a much more usable space to them if they were able to do this. And we don't feel that it would be any harm to any other abutters or citizens.
Any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yeah, I just want to validate the existing deck that's there. You're showing it as removed, and the intent is not to replace it with any other substitute deck of any sort up there.
Yes, that balcony deck would not be replaced.
Okay.
I had the same question.
Okay.
Sorry.
Any further questions from the board? Mr. LeMay?
Just a quick here. Do I see now the proposed roof is actually less yes, of a variance needed than what you have now?
Less of an overhang?
Less of an overhang.
Yeah, horizontally it would be more less non-conforming.
So it's an improvement in the encroachment?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
The questions? Here are none. Thank you. Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a variance to get rid of a sunken living room, get one flat level living space on the first floor, and raise the roof approximately 3 feet.
Mr. Chairman, I would move approval
Second.
Okay, your motion, please.
In essence, this is a very simple request. It will improve a nonconformance a little bit with respect to the criteria. Granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest. It's hard to see any public interest in this at all. It's going to improve the usefulness of the house for the folks who live there and not have any deleterious effect on anybody else, as far as I can see. Granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance system. It's to allow it these folks to make their house a little more usable for them, a little friendlier. Thirdly, granting the variance would do substantial justice. This is the case of where if we can find an overriding public interest, it would argue for a refusal, and there is none in my judgment on this case. Fourth, granting the variance will not diminish the value of surrounding properties. I suspect it will have no influence whatsoever with respect to surrounding properties one way or the other. And the unnecessary hardship test, the design is odd. It's inherent in the building as it is, as has been explained. It will make it more user-friendly for the folks in the area. So it meets, as far as I can see, it meets all the criteria without any question about it. And as I indicated earlier, nonconformance will be slightly reduced, I guess you could say that's in the public interest. So it meets all the criteria.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I agree and have nothing to add.
Okay. Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Raum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
And Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to case 3-8, the petition of Hunkin Holdings, LLC, property located at 311 Marcy Street, Assessor Plan Map 102, Lot 2, in the Zoning District General Residence B. They're looking to add an 8-foot by 12-foot one-story rear addition. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 to allow a lawful nonconforming building or structure to be extended or reconstructed without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance, and variances from Section 10.521 to allow a left side yard setback of 2.3 feet where 10 feet is required, and a rear yard setback of 3 feet where 25 feet is required. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Yes, good evening. Ann Whitney, the architect for the project. The owner is out of town. Before I get started, I have an email and then a list of the abutters that have taken a look at the drawings and don't have a problem. And on the back of that, I included a little tax map so you can see where they're located. It's basically all the abutters that are immediately in, you know, backing up the property.
Thank you.
As you can see from the site plan and the photos, is a very small lot with a very small structure on it, rather interesting, a little sort of American kind of Gothic or craftsman house, which hasn't had a lot done to it for a lot of years. I guess looking at the photographs, you can see currently on that right, it's sort of an unusual property. Let me back up a little bit, because the address is Marcy Street, even though the front door is on Pickering Street. It doesn't really matter, because the setbacks we'd be asking for relief either way, because the property is so tight to the, if you look at Marcy Street, to the left side property line. It's basically within a foot. It's slightly angled, but it's within a foot for that whole length. Currently, there's property is also out of the ground a ways, so currently in that location where we'll be putting this addition, there's a 6 foot by 7 foot five deck that's well over 18 inches that we'll be getting rid of. So what we're proposing is to put, you know, a one-story addition, 8 by 12, on this side. It's going to improve the setback slightly. Right now, it's about 1 foot 3 from that deck, and this will be about 2 foot 3 plus or minus from the that rear property line. I generated this plan. The map lot, map 102 lot 1 above had a had a survey done, so I was able to actually find the pins and locate, you know, that back property line in relation to this building, and there's a reference plan in the back of your packet. And the rest of it, I did measurements from the existing building to the street, to the curb cut. So it's not a perfect plan, but in the areas where we're asking for relief, it's as accurate as I can do. If you look at the floor plan, what we're trying to do, this is a very small house, is this addition will allow, you know, a second entry, second egress or an entry, and allow, it's basically a two-room house with a stair hall and a stair, and it'll allow that side where the kitchen is to actually have be able to have a table in it and a closet and provide a second access. And we are going to be putting a foundation under this so we can get rid of the sort of crawling in. Now there's just an opening on the side where you have to kind of crawl into the basement, and by putting a bulkhead in, we'll be able to have access through the basement, which is actually a nice dry basement that's is an asset on a small property like this. You know, this addition is connected to the existing residence, which at the location of where it's connected is just 0.3 feet from the that rear setback. And it's not uncommon for properties in this neighborhood to be tight to one or other of the setbacks. I couldn't print it, but old maps in the from Portsmouth that the client gave me, but I couldn't get them to print right, it actually showed an addition in this location, but it's been gone for at least probably 50 years or more. The 6.5 rear setback, you know, it still allows for access to that back of the corner lot, so it's a fairly tight little area behind there. And looking at how else we could add on to this, you know, we do have a big front yard, and you could add on to the front, but this is in the historic district, and it's a pretty classic period house, very unusual for this district, and it would really change the character. It would also interfere with getting a couple of off-street parking spaces if we were to add on to the front of the house. You know, with this addition, we're going to be still under 1,200 square feet for the entire, you know, living space of the property. In terms of the variance is not contrary to public interest. As you can see, there's pretty widespread neighborhood support. People are pretty happy that this little house is actually going to have a little work done to it. Where the location of the addition has minimal impacts on any street views. The special conditions I've already addressed in the fact that the existing building is sitting on that left side property line and very tight to the rear line. Consistent with the spirit of the ordinance, it's not unusual for, again, you know, properties and buildings in this area to be tight to their property lines. In this case, there's an offset where there is a big front yard, so it isn't like we're filling the entire lot up. Substantial justice. I think this minimal relief will have a large impact on this little property. Just adding that 96 square feet will really have a big impact on the livability of the first floor. And property value is not diminished. As you can see, there's pretty broad neighborhood support, and then any renovations to this project should just improve the value of adjacent properties. We do have to go through the HDC, so they'll hold my feet to the fire in terms of how it's going to look like. So are there any questions?
Any questions from the board?
Believe it or not.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
So you were thorough. Anyone else to speak in favor of the petition?
Jerry Ekman, I live
directly across the street at 326 Marcy Street. I fully support the granting of this variance. I think it will be a huge improvement to the property, to the street, to the neighborhood. I think it easily meets all of your criteria, and I think it will be a tremendous addition and should be granted. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? 2-4 against. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a couple setback variances.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we accept the application as presented and advertised.
Thank you. A second?
Prove it, not accept it.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you. Your motion, please.
Yes. This is another property I got an opportunity to visit on Monday, and just when you look at it in person, you really realize exactly how small this house truly is. Any kind of additional space that could be gained clearly would be an asset to such a small house. Also, as part of this presentation, it's not anything that we are directly approving, but there are a couple of small shed dormers being added to the property. I leave it up to the HDC to decide if a shed dormer is better than another gable dormer with the same Gothic look as that little bump out. But overall, again, what's being requested there for gaining some additional space in this very small house is very reasonable. One of the other aspects about this application that at first blush looks kind of difficult to approve is 6.5 feet on the back allowable setback. First of all, it's 3 feet on the allowable setback, where 25 feet is required. A couple things about that. One is the 3 feet is to the bulkhead, which is a relatively small portion of this this bump out. It's really 6.5 feet to the actual real story addition. Admittedly, the bulkhead does count as above 18 inches for most of its length, but nonetheless, from a light air perspective, the 6.5 feet is more representative. The other part about the this particular zoning that this building ends up in is general residence B, GRB, which is sort of like our GRA, but for smaller lots. So you go from 75,000 square feet down to 5,000 square feet for the allowable lot size. Similarly, other things are also reduced, 80 feet for street frontage. Depth is also smaller. Front yard requirement is smaller. But strangely, the rear yard requirement grows. It doesn't get smaller. I've spoken to a member of the planning board about that as something maybe we should take a look at, because it's in a couple of the cases that we've had before us, that's never made sense to me. So in this sense here, if you look at the fact that maybe like a 15 feet would be a more reasonable expectation for a back required for setback, 6.5 feet is now essentially closer to about half of that kind of a number, as opposed to compared to 25 feet. So all in all, I think it's a very reasonable request. This is another great example, I think, of where having a survey is important. Obviously, they were able to take advantage of a survey done by a neighbor, which is even better for them. But if you look at the tax map representation, it would indicate that they actually own a portion of the neighbor's garage, which the survey would indicate is in fact not true. So good example there, where a survey really helps us to fully define what we're looking at for proper setbacks here. And in this case, kind of hurts the applicant a little bit in the sense that they're not able to claim some of this property adjacent, but the honesty of it and gives us a true representation of what it is we're approving here is a bonus. So specifically to the criteria, granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest. We have widespread approval from the neighbors. It is in general keeping with the overall neighborhood, where you have a lot of these very, very small homes that you see in this area with usually fairly small additions. And in fact, what they're asking for here, again, is just a one-story addition. They're not asking to build it up to the full height, so it's really very modest in what's being asked for, supported by the neighbors and in keeping in general with the neighborhood. Obviously, it's kind of a unique house from an architectural standpoint with some of the unique aspects of it. So, we'll need to deal with that with the HTC, but overall, the public's interest is well served here. Granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. Again, as I touched upon, does seem like a lot of relief at first blush, but again, we're talking about very typical conditions for this neighborhood, where yes, it is in the GRB, but these houses are generally all very close together. And the rear line relief is somewhat modified by the points that I made about the nature of this particular zoning requirement. Granting the variance would do substantial justice. Again, very small home. This allows for a modest increase, as the applicant's architect has indicated. It even has the increased bonus of, with the new bulkhead, allowing the dry basement, because it's sort of on a hill, to take full advantage of that space, which every square inch is precious. So I think that this is, for the small amount of additional space that's being asked for here, there's a lot of benefits to the homeowner, and so substantial justice is met. Granting the variance would not diminish the values of surrounding properties. Again, this is an improvement to this home. With the abutters' approvals, would appear that they would tend to agree that this is only going to help to improve their property values and not diminish it. And finally, the hardship. There is a hardship, again, based off of the small size of the lot, size of this lot, where the residence is located on it, that gives this property some unique characteristics, and that there is no real fair and substantial relationship between general and public purposes of the ordinance and this specific application. So therefore, I recommend approval.
Your second, please.
I agree with the comments by Mr. Rayum, and I'd add that, basically we're dealing with a very modest addition that's being requested here to improve the functionality and access to the property. The rear yard setback's really the biggest issue that we're dealing with. The others aren't necessarily issues per se. And with respect to the rear yard setback, there's really no place to, there aren't many places to go here from a design perspective to accomplish the goals that are intended. So I think it's a very reasonable request, and I believe it meets all the criteria.
Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to the final petition of the evening, Mr. Moretti will be recusing himself. We will be moving ahead with five voting members. Case 3-9, petition of Robert Ritchie, Sr. Revocal Trust 9, and Robert Ritchie, Sr. Trustee Owner, and Robert Ritchie, Jr. Applicant. Property located at 75 Albany Street, Assessor Plan Map 156, Lot 26, in the Zoning District Mixed Residential Business. Looking to allow a furniture store in an existing building. This will require a special exception under Section 10.440, Use Number 8.31, to allow retail sales not marine related to be conducted within a building. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I'm Peter Laughlin. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Robert Ritchie Trust. And as you pointed out, we're seeking a special exception. This is the property that is presently occupied by the Portsmouth Music and Arts Center on Albany Street near Brewery Lane. And they are going to be moving to a new site, and I have a new tenant that would like to move in there, which is Weekenders. They sell furniture. And they presently operate across the street. Where they are now, they have no parking, and they use the parking on the Ritchie land right now. The Ritchie land the building, as you've probably seen, it was built in around 1950 by Robert Ritchie Sr.'s father, Arminio, and I'm told that it was a chicken coop on the second floor at one time. That burned. They salvaged the first floor. That's where Ritchie Construction was located for a number of years. When they vacated the premises, it was used by Potts Plus, who eventually moved to Islington Street. Then it was used, it was occupied after Potts Plus by Area Kitchen, and they moved to their present location. So it has had a retail use. Then it was used for office by Chuck Connors, had a detective agency in there, and Armin Laguerre had a security business in that location. So at the present time, the use is, I don't want to say fairly intense, but at times, I'm told they can have up to 50 or more people there with bands or whatever, and are practicing, and with the parking that's attendant. Now, there are at least 8 legitimate parking spaces on the site, and since there are 4,000 something square feet, and the parking requirement is ones for furniture retail sales is one space for every 600 square feet. And it fits under a category of allowed retail sales for non-marine retail sales. And it's allowed, as you point out, by special exception. And the conditions for a special exception spelled out in the materials that were spelled out and submitted, that there would be no changes to the building, there'd be no changes to the lot. It's just going to be a change inside, going from a the use that's there now to a significantly less intense use, and which will be in harmony with a neighbor. It meets the standards spelled out in the ordinance. There's no hazard to the public or adjacent property owners on account of potential fire, explosion, or release of toxic materials. There's no detriment to property owners in the vicinity or change in the essential characteristics of in the area, including residential neighborhoods or business and industrial zones. There's no problems because of smoke, dust, or other pollutants. There's no creation of a traffic or safety hazard, no excessive demand on municipal services, and no significant increase in stormwater runoff on adjacent properties. So basically, there'll be no, other than probably a sign, no visible change will occur on the property if the relief is granted. Thank you. And Bud and Butch Ritchie are both here if you have any questions.
Are there any questions from the board? Mr. Ayoun?
I just want to understand, is the property at 69 Albany Street also owned by the same individuals?
Yes.
Okay. So, and that's an odd, very odd-shaped lot, right? It's kind of got like this T shape to it. Must have like the most arcane property description on any deed that you've ever seen.
I don't know the history of that part of it.
Oh, okay. But it is completely separated, that lot completely separates 75 Albany Street from any of the properties on Cass Street. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? I'll just note that we do have one letter of opposition from Donna and Philip Miller from 74 Cass Street in regards to a fence and a property line dispute. Anyone else to speak in opposition? Anyone to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for a special exception to allow furniture sales. Where currently there is a music and arts center. Entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman,
I
would move approval as requested and presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you. Your motion, please.
This is strictly one variance, and it's for the use. There's nothing to do with setbacks or any new construction, and it's pretty straightforward. This area is very much mixed use, probably more commercial than residential. When you get closer to Cass Street, there's more residential, but it's very much a mixed use commercial area, and it has been that way for a long, long time. So in terms of the criteria, we're looking at a variance.
No, special exception.
I'm sorry, special exception. Yeah. I knew I was going to say that wrong. Special exception, which means that the use is allowed, provided it doesn't have deleterious effects with respect to the neighborhood, and specific things, six specific standards. The first one is that standards as provided by this ordinance for particular use are permitted by special exception, which it is, because it's retail. No hazard to the public or adjacent property on account of potential fire, explosion, and release of toxic materials. Those generally apply to manufacturing type operations or some sort of construction or repair. And this, in this case, that's not applicable because it's retail. No detriment to property values in the vicinity or change in the essential characteristics of any area, including residential neighborhoods or businesses and industrial districts. on account of the location or scale of buildings and on structures, et cetera, park, with respect to parking areas, accessways, odor, smoke, gas, dust, et cetera, pollutant, noise, glare, heat, vibration. Again, clearly aimed at industrial-type operations or heavy-duty work or something that is going to create noise or any of those other factors, environmental factors. Again, not applicable to here because it's a proposed use is retail, which is pretty benign. And as I said earlier, it's very much retail. It's very much, excuse me, a business area of various kinds of businesses. Fourthly, no creation of a traffic safety hazard or a substantial increase in the level of traffic congestion in the vicinity. It's not a particularly high traffic area anyway. And furniture stores, at least by my observation, just typically do not generate a lot of traffic. And fifth, no excessive demand on municipal services, including but not limited to water, sewer, waste disposal, police, and fire protection, and schools. Again, it's hard to see that there would be any impact with respect to any of those factors in this proposed use. And lastly, no significant increase of stormwater runoff into adjacent property or streets. No proposal, no aspect of the proposal is to change anything, so there certainly should be no increase or change it at all with respect to a stormwater runoff. So I think it clearly meets all the criteria for a special exception.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with and incorporate the comments of Mr. Parrott as my own, and therefore I second the motion.
Okay. Any further comment from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yeah, I'll just say I will be supporting the motion, although one thing I did forget to ask the applicant was if whether or not the proposed 8 parking spaces are going to be striped off. My only kind of concern with the whole traffic congestion is just to really make full use that parking area right now is sort of a free-for-all, and to really make sure they are, in fact, meeting the requirement with the 8 parking spaces, I would hope that they are going to go in and stripe that off, especially space number 8, which is sort of in a illogical location. So I think you'd really need to stripe that out to be able to encourage folks to park in that location.
Did you want to make that a stipulation, or
I'll let the makers of the motion decide whether or not that's important enough. It's just something that had occurred to me when I looked at the application. So
I guess I don't really feel strongly about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, so I'm fine. Just my personal point.
I've been like the 18th car to park on that lot if you don't stripe it.
It's kind of a free-for-all. I've seen it before.
So. All right.
I'm on my way to Pick and Pay, and yes, I still do call it Pick and Pay. So. Yeah.
Sure. Any further comment? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. The petition has been granted.
Thank you.
Before we adjourn, I would just, since we did pretty well time-wise, and we have some postponements being added next month, if we want to just quickly look at the effort that Juliet put into some of our comments in regards to the Board of Adjustment application itself and the rules and regulations. I just have a couple more house cleaning items. Second page of the application, about in the middle inside the boxes, mm-hmm. where it says scale of all drawings and plans. Just need a little space between drawings and. And towards the bottom, the applicant is encouraged to consider the following. The second one, use of,
yep.
color of highlights instead of use or.
Excuse me.
Let's see if I had anything on the. The only other thing I had on terms of Board of Adjustment rules and regulations, page 7, part 6, when we're talking about whether we hear a petition or not that hasn't changed significantly, I think it's worth noting Fisher versus Dover as a case law.
Okay. That one.
That one there.
Excuse me.
And then just add a period
yep.
after questions down there. That's all I had. And if anyone else had any comments or corrections
Just a couple of minor things. Sorry. On the second page of the application, under the minimum requirements, where it says scale of all drawings and plans, excuse me, those artist renderings that, I mean, the computer-generated renderings, the 3D renderings that we get, typically those don't lend themselves very well to dimensional, just as long as we don't mean them. We had several of them tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't really put dimensions on. I don't think those are designed to have dimensions on them.
No.
You know what I mean?
I mean, they can be helpful when they're done right.
Yeah. These weren't particularly.
You need support in.
As a compliment to, you know, another set of drawings or something, they could be helpful.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
But in lieu of, not so much.
Yeah. They'll be like those. And my other comment, I guess, is on the rules and regulations on page 7. At the top, an annual report shall be prepared by the chair and submitted to the city manager and conjunction with the planning department. I've often looked at that and said, what is that supposed to contain? It's not defined at all. So
I think
it might be useful to either eliminate it or spell out what's supposed to be in there.
Yeah, and I think I didn't even realize that was really in there. We basically just provide in the annual report that the city does, the planning department provides a list of the number of. We just basically give a summary of like the number of building variances granted and that kind of stuff, but we probably don't even review that with you guys. It's not.
I've never seen it.
I know. So we probably need to just clarify what that meant.
Yeah. Summarizing the
right.
Just
yeah. Yep.
Excuse me. Sorry.
You making more work for me, Arthur?
I am.
Write up a report.
No, you don't have to do it.
We just have to get your approval.
No. Question on the. Section that deals with
you, of course.
Question.
You're up.
Thank you. That deals with Fisher versus Dover. Does the language in the second paragraph, do you feel that puts any restriction on the board with respect to the latitude they can use at the meeting to ask for or to obtain comment? Because it says no presentation time or public comment session is to be allotted at the scheduled meeting, though the board holds the right to ask the petitioner questions. Now, you got the petitioner and you got the guy that's defending himself. So we certainly don't want to tie our hands in any way with language that might be selective.
I don't understand your distinction, I guess. But
well, you have a petitioner you can ask questions of, but
you
have somebody that you have another party involved that isn't a petitioner, I don't think, by the technical description.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just worried about whether this is. I can't suggest offhand a better way of stating it,
right,
which is the issue, but
maybe,
the board should have a lot of latitude there.
Interested parties?
Yeah, ask the parties questions, I suppose.
Interested parties, sure.
And that's fine, I guess, within the scope of us asking for information.
That does give, that doesn't isolate someone.
No.
I think I got a good point, Charles.
If I may add to that same paragraph, I guess I would like to see it maybe just a little bit clearer. When you mentioned Fisher v. Dover, that the applicant is encouraged to specifically address Fisher v. Dover case and why it should not apply.
Something like suggest review Fisher versus Dover.
Right. To give them a real guideline that
right.
You can actually submit something to us that talks to that if you want to go hire a lawyer or something to speak to that.
I like that because it doesn't sound like we just made it up.
Yeah.
It's case law.
Right.
Any other firm further comments?
Nope.
I think this is a nice set of revisions that we're due.
Mm-hmm.
Should help us out, do our job. Thank you for doing that.
Okay. So I'll make those tweaks, and then I'll have a final version. But we'll start using these in the planning department for our applications. Probably just get a final okay from you guys on the final version next time.
One more thing, if I can, I haven't gone back through looking at it specifically from this viewpoint, but one of the things that did come up tonight was the use of tax maps versus actual surveys. I don't know if we want to add in any kind of guidance or recommendation on that.
Yeah.
Like the case with the Marcy Street property is a great example in my mind of where tax maps really are completely different than what the survey tells you. And I also know from personal experience that that's also the case. So.
Yeah.
I think there's case law on the tax map issue. So that might be something that you ask legal to look at first. Because I've, in the absence of an applicant being able to pay for a survey, I've used tax maps and it's been upheld as valid and it's been challenged.
And I do recognize that the planning department and making some determinations as to whether relief needs to be granted or not usually goes to the tax maps as their first deference, just because surveys are tough to come by and can be incredibly expensive depending upon the neighborhood.
Yeah. So. Definitely would help the, on that one, though.
In that case, we did encourage them to get a survey, and then it's ultimately their decision. We can't require
it. Right. Yeah, they can't present it well. That's
So we can look into that maybe for future consideration.
That's fine. I just thought I'd bring it up since it was a very relevant topic tonight. So fresh on the brain.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, there are some situations where if they're just expanding back along an existing plane, plane, you know what you're getting, right?
Yeah.
Right. Whereas if it's jogging in 18, then you kind of, it's a little loosey, but sometimes you can visualize it because you're on a plane. But
so you use a tax map at your own peril?
Yeah, I mean, I think sometimes
it's... if we're in doubt, we may require something.
Sometimes it suffice, and other times it just, it's not.
I mean, that's where you pay for it.
It's the looking up the history.
All right. So I guess with that said, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. Favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. That was pretty quick work.
Oh, man.